heat, pressure, volume, and temperature. Pressure one, volume one, temperature two equals pressure two, volume two, temperature one. And the different variations to that particular gas law. So those are the ones when you're just dealing with pressure, volume, and temperature. Let me remind you of something before I forget. There is a playlist on our channel that is titled High School Science. And in order for you to learn about Graham's Law, what I need you to go when you're done with this, whenever you have time this week, and go to the one that is labeled for chemistry class, and go to the date that is March 30th and March 31st. There's actually two parts to it. So there's two videos you need to watch under chemistry, and that is March 30th to March 31st. And that is teaching you about Graham's Law. Those are pretty detailed, and they're as much as I wanted to cover. So instead of making another one, I'm just going to have you go watch those two. Remember that there's two, March 30th, March 31st. Therefore, Graham's Law of effusion and diffusion. Graham's Law of effusion and diffusion. So go ahead and please watch those. When you're done watching those, make sure you do the appropriate worksheets that go along with Graham's Law. What we're going to talk about today is what we call the ideal gas law. Ideal gas law. This is probably the lengthiest one. It's not more difficult to understand, but there are more components to it. So this is our ideal gas law. So if you want to go ahead and take out your sheet that has all of the formulas on it, take out your formula sheet so you can follow along, locate the square that says ideal gas law. You'll see the formula right there. It's one formula, ideal gas law. Now what I want you to notice with this is the components, which are PV equals NRT. PV equals NRT, pressure, volume, equals NRT. Now there's two there that you might not recognize just because we haven't seen them before, but PV and T, of course, as you know, they're abbreviated here because this is knowledge that you should have by now, are pressure, volume, and temperature. Pressure, volume, and temperature. Then you have two that you're not familiar with. You have N, and that is for number of moles. N is number of moles. Now you actually do know how to solve for number of moles. Remember when we worked a couple weeks ago on molar mass? When you look at your periodic table, you find its average mass, you multiply it by how much of the particular element you have, and then you put it over grams per mole. That is where you get number of moles from. That is related to that. So you have that knowledge. If you need to go back and watch that video or you need to look over those worksheets, make sure you do so. That is the one where you solve for grams per mole, molar mass. That is number of moles. Then you have R. R is a universal gas constant. It is a universal constant. When a constant is being used in science, it means that it's always given and does not change. It's always given and does not change. Now, the good thing about this is your R constant is already given to you on the formula sheet. So I want you to look down at the bottom right where it says gas laws equation symbol. So I need you to take it out and I need you to look at it where it says gas laws equation symbols, gas laws equation symbols. And towards the bottom, you'll see a capital R, capital R. That's what the R constant is for, capital R. Then you'll see that there are three different options, three different numbers. 8.31, you have 0.0821, and then you have 62.4. There are three options. Now, the more difficult part, quote unquote, about learning which R constant to use simply is based on the fact of which unit of pressure am I using? Which unit of pressure am I using? We'll discuss that later on. So once again, P is for pressure, V is for volume, N is for number of moles, R is a constant that's given for you, and T is for temperature. Remember the units for pressure, volume, and temperature. That's in a previous video. You need to go watch it. Please make sure you're familiar with it. And volume is always liters. And then, of course, temperature is always in kelvins. That still applies to this particular gas law. Just as a reminder, mm is a molar mass. That's grams per mole. If you're solving for N, that's G over molar mass. We'll discuss that later on. So let's actually look at a problem. So I'm actually looking at the worksheet that says ideal gas law problems at the top. So you might need to look for that one. It says ideal gas problems at the top. Ideal gas problems. And I'm going to read this problem. I think there are multiple ones that say ideal gas law. So I'm going to read the problem so you know which one I am doing, and that way you can locate it. It says, If I have 4 moles of a gas at a pressure of 5.6 atmospheres and a volume of 12 liters, what is the temperature? Once again, we have 4 moles of a gas at a pressure of 5.6 atmospheres and 12 liters. What is the temperature? So listen to that problem, locate it, and then we can continue. The first step to any gas law problem, as I've already told you, is to figure out which law am I using, which formula am I using. In this instance, we already know that it's ideal gas law because I told you, because it's an ideal gas law problem worksheet. But if this was mixed into all of your gas laws, the easiest way to calculate that this is my ideal gas law that I need to use is based on the context. Immediately it tells you 4 moles of gas. And as you recall, the only two formulas that use moles are Graham's law and the ideal gas law. So that automatically eliminates your combined gas law where it's just pressure, volume, and temperature. Now, the way I distinguish between Graham's law and ideal gas law is Graham's law deals with rates, how fast a gas is escaping or how fast a gas is diffusing or effusing. Now, I've read the problem and you'll notice that's not what's going on in this problem. A gas is not escaping. It's giving you moles of the gas. It's giving you a particular pressure, a particular volume, and it's asking for temperature. Now, based on your formula, PV equals NRT, you're given everything you need to solve for it except for temperature. So automatically it's safe to assume, well, that's my ideal gas law because it has number of moles and it also gives me all of the other components. So therefore, just on the basis of the process of elimination, you know this is the ideal gas law. As you see more problems, it'll become a lot easier to calculate that. So the first thing is, which formula am I using? We've just deducted. It's the ideal gas law. Always, always, always write out your formula. That's with any science problem that uses formulas. You always want to start off by writing out your formula. So I've written out right here, PV equals NRT, pressure, volume, number of moles, R constant, temperature. Then my second step is to figure out my unknowns, to say, what am I solving for? So my knowns, as you can see there, there are 4 moles of gas. So that's my N, that's a given. Then I have a pressure of 5.6 atmospheres. That's automatically P for pressure. It says a volume of 12 liters, that's my V. So I have PV and I have N so far. Then your R is something you never solve for. Your R is always given. So you may not see it in the words in the problem, but your R is always given because it is a universal constant. R is given in the formula sheet. So you have to make sure you have that out in order for you to locate it. So your R is given, your P, your V, your N and your R are always given. The only thing you're missing is your T, which it tells you right there, what is the temperature? So once I know my unknowns, which is my T in this instance, I'm going to rearrange my formula. So first write out the formula, figure out your unknowns. When you figure out your unknowns, you're gonna rearrange your formula to solve for the unknown. So what I did underneath is I isolated my T. Because I'm solving T for temperature, I'm going to leave it by itself. How did I do that? I divided this side by NR in order to leave it by itself. What I do to one side, I have to do to the other side. So rearrange T equals PV over NR. Because I divided this side by NR, I'm gonna do it by the other side. Simple math, simple algebra, T equals PV over NR. That is an essential step in order to solve your ideal gas law. If you don't know or understand this, you make sure you go back and you rewatch. Once again, this is a simple math concept. In order for you to solve for temperature, you're gonna have to rearrange your formula. So once again, my formula rearranged, temperature equals pressure times volume over number of moles times my R constant. Now, everything after that is simply just plugging in your formula. So we have P for pressure, V for volume, number of moles is N, R is my constant. I've put my formula outstretched right here, and I'm just gonna fill in the spot. So my first one is P for pressure. I know my pressure is atmospheres because I've learned that that is my unit. So I'm gonna look at the problem. It tells me I have 5.6 atmospheres. 5.6 atmospheres, right there. Then at the top, I'm also gonna have my volume. My volume tells me there are 12 liters. I know my unit for volume is always liters, so therefore I know 12 goes right there. If it were in milliliters or centimeters cubed, you gotta make sure you convert that. That applies to this concept as well. Then at the bottom, I'm going to have N for number of moles. Tells you right there, you have 4 moles of a gas. 4 moles of a gas goes right there. Then my tricky part is my R constant. It actually looks a little bit weird when the units are written out. Once again, this is just simply given to you. When something's given to you, you write it out exactly how it is. You do not change anything about it. So, how do I know which R constant to use? Remember, I told you that you're going to use your unit of pressure. So I'm gonna look at pressure, I already know it's atmospheres. So I'm going to refer back to my formula sheet right at the bottom where it says R, and I'm going to look for the one that has the atmospheres in it. So I'm gonna see there is kPa. The first one is for kPa, 8.31 is for kPa's. Then my second one is for atmospheres, 0.0821 is for atmospheres. My third one is for torres, 62.4 is for torres. So I'm not using torres, which is my third one. I'm not using kilopascals, which is my first one. I'm gonna use my second one, which is 0.0821. That is for atmospheres. So when I'm working with the ideal gas law and I'm dealing with atmospheres, my number is always going to be 0.0821. 0.0821. That's probably a number you want to write down or you want to be familiar with. This is when you are working with atmospheres. Notice how liters, moles, and kelvins is part of your unit for your R constant, but the only thing that changes is your pressure. Look at kilopascals, it's still liters, moles, kelvin, but kilopascals is replacing atmospheres. The same thing with the third one. 0.0821. So I have my four components of my ideal gas law. I have pressure, volume, number of moles, R constant. The next two steps are very easy, and all you're going to do is multiply across, and then you're gonna divide. I've already done that for you. When you multiply 5.6 times 12, you're actually going to get 67.20. Then, when you multiply 4 times 0.0821, you're gonna get 0.3284. Now, my only unit left is Kelvin. Why is that? I'll show you here, atmospheres, and atmospheres cancels each other out. Liters and liters also cancels each other out. And then moles and moles. Notice how this is a fraction within a fraction, which is something that you can see in math and science. This is still at the top of the fraction, and this is still at the bottom. So moles and moles also cancel each other out. So notice all of the units except Kelvin have canceled each other out. Also refer back to your problem. You're actually solving for temperature, which means that since Kelvin is a unit of temperature, I am doing my problem correctly. Only Kelvins is left, so I'm gonna transfer it down right here. Kelvins equals temperature, you know that's true. The only thing left is to divide the numerator by the denominator. So once you divide 67.20 by 0.3284, you're going to get 204.63 Kelvins, 204.63 Kelvins. Once again, all I did was multiply across, then divide. Now, I'd like for you to stay as condensed as possible when you're writing out your answers. If you just plug in all of the four numbers, this times this, then divide by that, sometimes it gives you varying answers. I'd like for you to do the top first, the bottom second, and then divide. Take it step by step. It takes you an extra 10 seconds maybe. It's okay, you're gonna get the right answer. Once again, multiply across, then divide. Once you get your final answer, make sure you give it to me in two decimal places. You go to your second decimal place and you round correctly. And then lastly, you put your right unit, the correct unit you're supposed to put there. One of the larger mistakes is a lot of you will tend to focus, am I doing this right? Am I doing this right? And that's good, and you're probably doing it right. But at the end, either you get so excited that you have the right answer, or you're so nervous that you're not sure if you're right, and you forget to put a unit, or you put the incorrect one. It's simple. Read the problem. It says, what's the temperature? The temperature is always Kelvin. Put the K right there. It's that simple. Let me recap, and then we're done with this video. Ideal gas law is PV equals NRT, pressure, volume, number of moles, R constant, temperature. Rearrange your formula depending on what it is that you're solving for, depending on your unknown. I've rearranged it. You know how to solve for pressure, volume, number of moles was given. Your R constant is something you check for on your formula sheet based on your pressure. please make sure you base it on your pressure. In this instance, it's atmosphere, so I'm gonna put 0.0821, I'm gonna multiply across, divide, get your final answer. Make sure it corresponds with the correct unit that it is asking you for. I'm going to make a second video in order for you to understand another concept, but it's still ideal gas law. It's that simple. Follow the steps exactly every time, and you're gonna get these right.